Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Eva, especially for still considering me as being young. Well, it is indeed true for both of us with regard to the median age of CLL patients. Here are my disclosures, because coming back already, this is an introduction already. As you all know, CLL is a typical disease of the elderly patient, which was mentioned already before by Emily Mosera, that the majority of the patients is older than 70 years old. However, the incidence increases significantly in those patients above the age of 85 years. But on the other hand, we know the majority of our patients do not need treatment at the beginning, and therefore, especially among these elderly patients here, many patients die with their CLL without needing treatment. With the elderly patients, we focus the problem that the comorbidity burden is significantly higher in these patients than, for example, in patients with other lymphomas. This table shows to you an overview about, on the one hand, 1,195 patients from the Mayo Clinic who came with newly diagnosed CLL, and you can see that 89% of the patients had any comorbidity and 46% even severe comorbidities. In contrast to that, patients participating in clinical studies are clearly selected. In a meta-analysis from our study group, among 554 patients requiring treatment, the median age was 61 years, so significantly lower, and 53% had any comorbidity and only 25% a major comorbidity. This is also due to the fact that many clinical trials exclude patients with certain comorbidities, for example, severe heart diseases, or also with impaired renal function, for example, and therefore many clinical trials are not representative. However, in the past 10 or 15 years, there are more and more clinical studies, as already pointed out by Peter Hillman before, who address the treatment in these elderly patients. There are very nice works showing again the prognostic value of the comorbidity burden. One of the works is here from Emily Monserrat's group from Barcelona, showing in 259 patients in whom an evaluation of the comorbidity burden according to the cumulative illness rating scale, the so-called CIRS score, was done. And this, as this graph shows, those patients with a lower comorbidity burden had a better outcome than those with a higher comorbidity burden. And a similar work by the Mayo Clinic in more than 1,000 patients showed also here patients with major comorbidities present in CLL had a significantly worse outcome. However, in spite of that, most of the patients die because of the CLL, also those patients with more comorbidities. This is again a work from our group on meta-analysis showing to you the reason for deaths among patients treated within clinical studies, and you see that the biggest proportion of patients died because of CLL if they had less, more or less comorbidities, showing that 60% of all patients requiring treatment die because of the leukemia and not because of their other diseases, even if they are present already at the time point of treatment initiation. So when we have typically elderly CLL patients, we have to deal with several problems in those patients, which are the activities of daily living, which are sometimes impaired, the social support these patients need. We know that the immune system has, we have an immunosenescence in the immune system by age. The physical fitness is impaired. Nutritional status probably plays a very big role in the tolerance of treatment. Comorbidity, as already addressed, but also depression, cognitive function, renal function, and of course the problem with the polypharmacy, which may become a bigger problem in the future with all the new drugs which have interactions in some parts with the new drugs. How can we do a good geriatric assessment? The problem is, of course, that this needs some time, and this is just an overview about the different assessment scores we have in oncology. I think everybody uses WHO Karnofsky performance status, but scores like ADL or IADL need already a little bit more time. Then scores like Time Up and Go can be done, for example, just stopping the time the patient needs to walk to your office, for example. We have several tools for measuring comorbidities. The most prominent, probably the Charlson Index or the Cumulative Illness Rating Scale. I think for transplantation, the HCT-CI score is well established now. But there are a number of other scales. I don't want to go into detail in all of this, but showing to you that geriatricians spend a lot of time just doing this assessment at the first time point. However, this has, but the geriatric, or at least some aspects of the geriatric assessment have a significant impact on the outcome of this patient. This is a table I got from Marie Hamaker, a geriatrician from Utrecht in the Netherlands, and she has written some really very nice overviews about those works focusing on different comorbidity or geriatric assessment scores, mostly in hematopoietic neoplasias, but also in some various other neoplasias. So on this part of the table, you see those geriatric scores which were assessed, and the result was positive in a multivariate analysis. And you see here with yellow that at least from those six studies, three had a positive outcome for the comorbidity being a prognostic factors, another few for objective physical capacity, and some more for nutritional status. Other geriatric assessments, as for example the activities of daily living, probably do not play such a big role, probably especially not in hematologic malignancies. So far we have to say we do not have an ideal score or something that combines everything, especially in hematologic malignancies, but many studies now evaluate these scores in the clinical studies, and there are also in CLL them efforts going to be made to trying to establish a score on an international basis. We do not need these scores only for determining the prognosis of elderly CLL patients, but also maybe for changing our treatment. And this is again an overview from Maria Hamaker, showing to you clinical studies evaluating the influence of the geriatric assessments on treatment alterations. And as you can see, after geriatric assessments, in 20 to 49% of the patients, the treatment was changed. In the majority, a less intensive treatment was administered, but there was also one study showing that an even more intensive treatment was done after a geriatric assessment. I have to say this was not only done in hematologic malignancies, but also in patients with solid tumors. So again, this shows to you we should spend some time for doing some geriatric assessment, whatever your preference choice is, in order to determine the prognosis and to adapt the treatment. Because as we heard already before, chemoimmunotherapies are now the standard treatment in frontline therapy, but for these elderly patients, we have to consider how intense the chemoimmunotherapy should be. So for those patients being fit enough, we still can give very intensive treatment independent from the age, which is, of course, the minority of the patients only. But we know FCR is also applicable in patients above the age of 70 years. However, a recent update from the FCR study from the MD Anderson showed among those 156 patients with a relapse after FCR that those patients who were above the age of 65 years did significantly worse at the time point of relapse when they were older than 65 years than those patients of younger age, which is related to the fact that these patients are not suitable for all treatments anymore at the time point of relapse. This was addressed by Emily before. We have on the one hand the very fit group of patients, and we have the slow go group, those patients receiving mild therapy only. But there is probably also a group in between those patients, patients who have a low comorbidity burden but are of higher age, and maybe they have a little bit of impaired renal function, so we couldn't give full dose FCR anyhow. And this is a group of patients which may benefit from bendamustine plus rituximab. This was addressed already before. Data on BR in fit elderly patients are available, as far as I know, from three studies. This was our Seattle 10 study, which was already presented to you, and Peter Hellman has already shown to you those for the data for those patients above the age of 65 years. They achieved very promising, also complete remission rate with 57% progression-free survival at 3 years. In a phase two study, we observed a similar median time to progression with a median of 38 months. And I hope that Véronique Leblanc will publish very soon the data of the MABEL study. This was the only study addressing so far really a comparison between bendamustine plus rituximab versus clombazil plus rituximab in elderly patients being selected here as not suitable for FCR treatment. And the overall response here is also in a very high range, and 30% complete remissions were achieved. However, you see that also with BR, there was a significant rate of severe neutropenia, so severe infections are rather mild and are especially milder than, for example, with FCR treatment. Then there, on the other hand, we have the group of those patients being less fit and patients who should receive mild therapy, which was frequently in the past clombazil, at least in Europe. In the US, rituximab monotherapy was one regimen which was administered frequently. And for those patients, less intensive, chemoimmunotherapy is applicable, and I can switch over this because you have seen that already twice. Just showing you, we have with FCR, we have nearly 60 months of median progression-free survival now with the combination of GO101 plus clombazil in less fit patients. We are now achieving 30 months median progression-free survival with obinutuzumab, which is already doubling the median time to progression in comparison to rituximab plus obinutuzumab in the recent update. But still, we are very much behind the efficacy of FCR treatment in young patients. And similar for ofatumumab plus clombazil, also a significant improvement in comparison to clombazil monotherapy. But this is definitely a group where it's much more improvement to be evaluated, improvement to be done than in the young and fit patients. What about the side effects between those three different clombazil-based CD20 antibody combinations? Adding antibodies means, of course, we have to deal with infusion-related reactions, which were mild, probably also because we are quite well used to use rituximab, which were 10% with ofatumumab, and here but 20% with obinutuzumab. So we have a significant increase in infusion-related reactions, and all or nearly all of these reactions occurred only during the first administration of the antibody. This has probably something to do with the antigen-dependent cell cytotoxicity and with NK cells playing a role. And therefore, for the first administration of obinutuzumab, especially in the elderly patient, the dose should be splitted, and premedication is really necessary in those patients. However, we also see a higher rate of thrombocytopenia with the obinutuzumab, so for the higher efficacy with this antibody, we pay some price with regard on the side effects. As already addressed, there is a question right now, can we replace chemoimmunotherapy by chemotherapy-free new treatment regimen? And this was a study performed in the U.S. administering ibrutinib in 31 treatment-naive elderly CLL patients, showing excellent progression-free survival and overall survival. And a recent update of the study, including relapse patients with a median observation time of 3 years, shows, especially in those treatment-naive patients, a continuous excellent progression-free survival and overall survival curve. You have seen the data from this study from Paolo Ghia and Emily before, and this was another study being performed in elderly patients with idelalisib plus rituximab versus placebo plus rituximab, showing the superiority, not surprisingly, of the idelalisib, and some people making jokes because this is the first big study evaluating rituximab monotherapy and showing that what was frequently used in the U.S. is not very effective. We only achieve median time to progression of 7 months with rituximab monotherapy. And of course, idelalisib is very effective in this relapse situation, and you have seen that before, therefore I will skip that. And I would like to come again comparing the adverse events between those two substances, because both are licensed, at least in Germany, in the same treatment indication, relapse CLL or frontline 17p deletion. And I think in many countries it will be the same. And therefore, the question is which drug to use. So probably ibrutinib may be a little bit better with regard on the efficacy, and idelalisib is only licensed in combination with rituximab. Fatigue is mostly mild, and only a few severe fatigues are reported. Diarrhea is a problem, but especially a problem with idelalisib, so the incidence rate here appears similar, but from the patient's view, these diarrhea occurring with idelalisib, they occur a little bit later after starting the treatment. They are really severe and really cumbersome for many of the patients. On the other hand, we see now also with longer follow-up that hypertension remains a constant adverse event with this continuous treatment with ibrutinib, and therefore especially in elderly comorbid patients having hypertension anyhow, that means we probably have to address the other medication while we administer, for example, ibrutinib as a continuous medication. Similarly, sorry, I missed here to add the number. Similarly, atrial fibrillation also occurs in around 10% of the patients during ibrutinib treatment, which might also be a problem. And infections are on the continuous treatment reported in 13 to 17%. However, we know CLL patients will, especially elderly CLL patients, will develop infections anyhow. This slide just summarizes some more of my personal thoughts when I have, I'm going to be asked from an elderly patient what drug to choose. Ibrutinib should not be administered concurrently with warfarin. There are several studies now showing that there's an interaction of ibrutinib with the aggregation together of the thrombocytes with von Willebrand factor, and that ibrutinib is definitively may cause some bleeding. However, in most of the studies, the bleeding events were only grade 1 and 2, and there were really only a few percentage, like 2 or 3% of severe bleedings in patients. However, it's not recommended to administer warfarin concurrently with ibrutinib. So if your patient is on warfarin, you can change him to some other anticoagulant treatment like factor 10 inhibitors, for example. But I would really discuss this with the patient that he may have an increased risk of bleeding. There was a recent study being presented at ASH also showing that the treatment is safe for those patients receiving anticoagulant treatment, but I think this has to be discussed with the patient before you start him. Then I've already mentioned diarrheas are usually more severe with, or at least what the clinical experience is with idelalisib, which this may cause also problems in the elderly, that they have to be admitted to hospital. So idelalisib can sometimes reintroduced after stopping idelalisib, giving oral or topic steroids, for example, and then at the second attempt it's tolerated. But of course, elderly patients might suffer from these severe diarrheas. Pneumonia, pneumonitis occurs probably in a similar extent in both treatments. Then the co-medication, which is frequently in elderly patients, with CYP3A4 inhibitors or inducers, especially with ibrutinib, you should be cautious. But on the other hand, there was no increased toxicity with higher ibrutinib levels. And as we mentioned before, QT prolongation, atrial fibrillation is another side effect with ibrutinib. And finally, of course, with these oral drugs in elderly patients, there is a question of compliance if the patients take already a number of drugs in the morning. So with ibrutinib, they have to take the drug only once in the morning with the three tablets, and for idelalisib, it's two times a day. So you can control both of them, and I think regarding the compliance, it probably depends more on the side effects, how compliant the patient is, and of course on the benefit of the treatment. With that, I would like to finish and just showing you what results can we expect on treatment of elderly CLL patients in the next time as again being the next on the next step. So there is one study from Pharmacyclics, the Resonate 2 study, comparing ibrutinib versus clambosil in frontline therapy of patients above the age of 65 years. I think the study will probably be presented at this year's ASH meeting. Since this comparator is very weak, there is, I think, no doubt that ibrutinib will be shown to be better. And this is also, I don't know if the agencies will approve ibrutinib on the basis of this data in frontline therapy in general, because this is not anymore the standard treatment. We use now clambosil plus CD20 antibody. Another study also performed in the U.S. by the Intergroup is a three-armed study, again focusing on LLCL patients and comparing bendamustine plus rituximab versus ibrutinib alone versus ibrutinib plus rituximab. And so there's a chemoimmunotherapy arm included. The study is surprisingly recruiting very well in the U.S., and we started in Germany, or no, internationally, the ZL-14 protocol. And this study protocol is addressing unfit patients defined according to the CIL score and creatinine clearance. And we are currently doing a safety run-in phase with ABT-199, the BCL-2 inhibitor, plus obinutuzumab. We give three doses of obinutuzumab before we start with the ABT-199, which can cause very severe and life-threatening tumor lysis syndrome. And of course, this was a special concern in the elderly patients. However, we dosed the ABT so far in four patients, and with the debulking of the three antibody administrations so far, no patient developed tumor lysis syndrome. So probably with a more sequential start of the new treatment regimen, if we will use new combinations, this is better tolerated in elderly patients. And we will probably start in June randomizing between our current standard, at least in Germany, with obinutuzumab plus clambosil versus GA101 plus ABT-99. And with that, I would like to summarize what are the treatment options of comorbid CLL patients. Of course, we should only treat patients in advanced stages. And I think with now in the era with the new agents, 17p lesion status and P53 mutation is relevant also in the elderly patients. If this is absent, clambosil plus CD20 antibody is the treatment of choice. As already addressed before, I don't know about the role of rituximab, and we don't have any data comparing ofatumumab versus obinutuzumab, so we don't really know which of these two antibodies is better. Then if patients have a 17p lesion and P53 mutation, ibrutinib or idelalisib are probably the best treatment option in those patients if available. And in case of relapse, I would really not necessarily recommend to switch every patient at the first relapse to the new drugs if the remission duration was very long or longer than 2 to 3 years, as discussed before. First-line treatment can be repeated, and only if the relapse occurs earlier, a treatment with the new drugs, but also other studies, for example, or other treatment regimen as FCR-lite or bendamustine plus rituximab are a treatment option. And with that, I would like to finish and thanking a group of people who gave a lot of input for this talk regarding comorbidities. This was a meeting of the SIOC task force, and all these people mentioned here attended, and I learned a lot, and would like to thank especially Maria Hamacher with regard to a geriatrician, which gives a little bit more input to our field. Thank you very much for your attention. Mm-hmm.